Hello, Internet, and welcome to another episode of That's All I Have to Say About That, Supreme Court Saturday. As always, I'm your host, Stephen Mackey. Today we're talking about the separation of church and state. And sorry we didn't release this last week, but that would have probably come off more war on Christmassy than Starbucks releasing a special Jesus is Not the Prophet cup for the holiday season. Now, if you aren't religious, don't worry, because as we'll cover in this episode, you definitely get yours as well. So let's get started with the Constitution itself. In the Constitution, much like minority actors at award shows, mention of God is conspicuously absent. That said, the basis for religious freedom is set in stone. Parchment. Now let's start with Article 6 of the actual OG Constitution. Not an amendment actually penned in by the Founding Fathers themselves. That said, no religious test shall ever be required as a qualification to any office or public trust under the United States. So when you see something like,
you have to swear on a Bible to be an elected official in the United States of America, he alleges that a Muslim cannot do that ethically, swearing on the Bible.
You don't actually have to swear on a Christian Bible. You can swear on anything, really. I don't know if you knew that. You can swear on a Jewish Bible.
Oh, no, I swore on the Bible. I've done it three times.
I'm sure you have.
That would be unconstitutional. That said, I'm not sure you can swear in on anything. Swear me in on a kid's menu from Chuck E. Cheese and see how that works out. That said, if the only thing keeping your elected officials from working against your best interests is the fact that they swore it on a Bible, you got yourself a bad leader. The First Amendment, an amendment that will come up a few times in this episode, says Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Now, for those of you who might have had a small heart attack right there, don't worry, this doesn't give people the right to blow themselves up in public if it's for a religious purpose. It just means that Congress could not create a new law specifically designed to denigrate an otherwise law-abiding religion. Now that we got that out of the way, let's really get started with 1879's Reynolds versus United States. This was a major First Amendment debate over a subject that's aged about as well as your mom's old record collection. I didn't know the Bee Gees wrote so many albums. Anyways, George Reynolds, a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, was being charged under the Moral Anti-Bigamy Act. At this time, there was a huge push against polygamy in American society, because it was the 1880s and the bond between a man, his wife, and his mistress was sacred. The Mormons, believing that these laws were violating their First Amendment rights, countersued when Mr. Reynolds was found guilty, and it went to the Supreme Court. They argued that their freedom to practice Mormonism was being unjustly violated by this law. Therefore, it was violating their First Amendment rights. The Supreme Court determined that this anti-polygamy could be traced back to Old English laws from King James, because laws are like fine wines. The older they are, the better. Isn't that right, minorities? The court was also worried, and this is true, that if they legalized polygamy, what would be next? Would someone want legal human sacrifices for religious purposes? Well, Reynolds ended up being sentenced to 2 years hard labor in prison and a fine of, adjusted for inflation, $11,145.20. Although that's probably a vacation compared to having two wives. That said, the ruling didn't include divorce because that makes sense. That's like charging a man with robbery and then letting him keep the cash. Next to 1947's Everson versus Board of Education. This was truly a landmark case in interpreting the separation of church and state, because up to this point there had been interpreted as protecting religion from the state, but this reinterpreted as separating the state from religion. Now you're probably imagining something dramatic like removing the Ten Commandments from a government office, or something equally polarizing, which people on both sides would know which side they stood on. But this was somewhat more morally confusing. You see, there was this man named Everson in New Jersey who was angry that the state was providing reimbursements for public transportation for students who attend both public and private schools, including religious schools. Now, Everson decided to sue the Board of Education for New Jersey to get them to stop helping children in private religious schools pay for transportation. Oh man, liberals, have fun celebrating this pioneer. Anyways, the Supreme Court actually found no problem with this case, as payments were going to all children, and more specifically, their parents and not a religious institution. And this brings us to 1948's McCollum vs. Board of Education, in which Vashti McCollum's son was attending a public school that had a voluntary Christian class that wasn't very voluntary. She alleged that students were either coerced or forced to attend these classes, and that her son was being ostracized and made fun of for skipping out on them. Because apparently, all of the bullies and cool kids were going to their weekly 35-minute voluntary Christian class instead of meeting behind the school to break every commandment short of murder. She alleged that, because this was a specifically Christian class being taught at a public school, it was a violation of the First Amendment Establishment Clause that says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Which ensures the separation of church and state. The Supreme Court took her side and ended the practice, removing 35 minutes in school breaks from 2,000 communities nationwide offering similar release time programs, and this affected 1.5 million students. Come on, Ms. McCollum, it's like Columbus Day. Just enjoy the time off and don't think about why you're getting it. Next to 1952's Joseph Bernstein Inc. vs. Wilson, which called into question the merits of the Fellini film Il Miracolo, a film made famous for being sued by Christians, and little else. A part of the film depicts Saint Joseph raping a disturbed peasant who believes herself to be the Virgin Mary, which, unsurprisingly, sparked protests with people carrying signs like, "Don't enter the cesspool. This picture is an insult to every decent woman and her mother." Wow, that might have been a little long for a sign, but you could definitely trim that down to a slogan. And of course, since it was the 1950s, don't be a communist. Now that guy might have gone to the wrong protest. Don't be a communist. Allow the government to censor our movies. That said, rather than arguing for censorship under obscenity laws, they argued for censorship under sacrilege laws and lost the case. And because of this, it is now illegal for the government to censor based on sacrilege. This brings us to 1962's Engel vs. Vitale, in which Engel, a Jew, sued the public school his son was attending for having a voluntary school prayer to Almighty God. Talk about taking school spirit too literally. Now, it all sounded pretty innocuous. Almighty God, we acknowledge our dependence upon thee, and we beg thy blessings upon us, our parents, our teachers, and our country. Amen. Heck, I might have even said it if I had a hard test that day. That said, it went to the Supreme Court, and boy were people on both sides pretty passionate about this one. 22 states signed a document urging the Supreme Court to maintain that it was acceptable behavior, while the American Jewish Committee, the Synagogue Council of America, and the American Ethical Union urged the Supreme Court to vote it unconstitutional. Wow, not sure why, but the Jews really seem to hate this one. In the end, it was ruled unconstitutional, and the first of many rulings we'll be talking about limiting prayer in public schools. Next to 1968's Epperson vs. Arkansas, in which Susan Epperson, a biology teacher in Little Rock, included a chapter on evolution. Unfortunately for her, in 1928, Arkansas passed a law making it a criminal offense to teach evolution in school, so she was brought up on charges. Now that might sound crazy, but after a quick Google search, I can also tell you that in Little Rock's laws, school teachers who bob their hair will not get a raise, and a man can legally beat his wife, but not more than once a month. So let's temper our expectations a little bit. That said, banning the teaching of evolution in schools was still found to be unconstitutional, as the separation of church and state means that a fact-based curriculum could not be bent to avoid offending individuals on religious grounds. This brings us to 1971's Lemon vs. Kurtzman. Now this case is a little confusing, but it created a very important test that we continue to use to evaluate constitutionality of potentially religious laws today. A Pennsylvania school district had a law stating that private schools could receive reimbursements from the public school superintendent if they taught from public textbooks using public school materials. Now, these private schools, for the most part, were either Catholic or too rich to care about reimbursements, which is where the problem arose. Was the government funding Catholic schools unfairly? Well, the Supreme Court used the Lemon Test to figure that out. Man, why couldn't that guy have had a more normal name? The Lemon Test? Hey, at least you remember what it's called. The Lemon Test has three prongs. First, the statute must have a secular legislative purpose. So no mandatory school watch sessions of John Travolta's Scientology epic Battlefield Earth. Secondly, the effect of the statute must not advance nor inhibit a religion. And this was actually the prong that got Donald Trump's Muslim ban ruled unconstitutional. And third, the statute must not result in an excessive government entanglement with religion. Which, it was found that in this case there was, because the only places benefiting from this program were Roman Catholic schools. Now to the next case of 1980's Stone vs. Graham, in which the stone should have represented the multi-ton stone Ten Commandments statue that was removed from the courthouse, just in case a defendant needed to remember that thou shalt not kill on his way to trial. It was accused of violating the First Amendment, as it is considered religious iconography. But interestingly enough, in other cases, such as Texas, the Ten Commandments were allowed to stay up when it was argued that they were a historical representation of justice instead. When asked about his loss, Stone rhetorically asks, "What would Moses have to say?" To which I would respond, "Isn't Moses the one who smashed the Ten Commandments?" Now to the case of 1985's Wallace vs. Jaffee, another victim of the Lemon Test. In this case, in Alabama, a law was introduced that allowed teachers to provide a silent minute at the start of each day to allow for prayer or meditation. Now that might sound reasonable, but the question the Supreme Court asked was why? I mean, a silent minute before a class does sound like the perfect amount of time for someone to cram for their geography test, or almost fall asleep, but there was no particularly good justification for it that could satisfy the Lemon Test requirement that laws of any statute have to have a clear secular purpose. And this one just didn't. Now to 1987's Edwards vs. Aguillard. Remember how it was earlier decided that you can't teach evolution in public schools? Well, it turns out that when the environment changed, Christian education acquired new traits to allow it to thrive. I just wish we had a word for that. Anyways, Louisiana passed a law mandating that public schools teach creationism beside evolution. It was successfully argued that this law was designed to advance a religious agenda, and the law was found unconstitutional. This brings us to an ethically tricky case of 1989's County of Allegheny versus American Civil Liberties Union. Now, there were three symbols on display in downtown Pittsburgh: a menorah, a Christmas tree, and a nativity scene. And I realize it sounds like the setup to a terrible joke. A menorah, a Christmas tree, and a nativity scene all go to court. Interestingly enough, the fate of each of these pieces of iconography was different. The Christmas tree didn't even make it into court because it was so obviously acceptable as a mainstream decoration. The menorah was ruled in court to be similar iconography to the Christmas tree, so it was allowed to stay. But poor old baby Jesus. Using the Lemon Test, it was deemed as too apparent that the nativity scene was promoting a Christian agenda, and it was mandated to be taken down. Although, really, what's more Christmassy than walking around with Jesus, Mary, and Joseph looking for a place to stay because everywhere is either full or won't take them? Now to the best and last case of the night, 1993's Church of the Lukumi Babalu Ava versus City of Hialeah. And man, did I just brutalize every word I just said, even worse than this religion brutalizes chickens. The religion in question is Santeria. Yes, the one from the song. A religion that involves ritualistic sacrifice of chickens and small animals. Apparently, Miami was not a big fan of theirs, and when they tried to expand their religion, Miami put in place some very interesting laws, including sacrificing animals of any kind was illegal, even if they were to be eaten, exempting, of course, kosher slaughterhouses, regular slaughterhouses, hunting, fishing, pest extermination, euthanasia of stray animals, and feeding live rabbits to greyhounds. And when you have to exempt that many people from a law, it kind of feels like you're targeting someone. And I love how feeding live rabbits to greyhounds got its own exception. I can only imagine what the greyhound lobby was. What? We can't feed live rabbits to dogs anymore? Dead rabbits? That's just not the same. What are we, animals? Get me the councilman right now! Unfortunately, the councilman would have been busy making speeches about how this religion worshipped demons with abhorrent religious practices, was against everything this country stood for, and in his home country of Cuba, would have been thrown in jail to the applause of crowds, and passing a resolution to prohibit all religious groups which are inconsistent with public morals, peace, or safety. It was found that this clearly violated the rights of the people who practice Santeria, and these laws were found to be unconstitutional. And that's how we got to our current laws regarding separation of church and state. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube! I hope you enjoyed that last video. For more episodes of Supreme Court Saturday, click here! Please like and subscribe, and if you're really a fan, you can check out our That's All I Have to Say About That Facebook group. It is just a party over there.